BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Lauren Laverne here. We're taking our summer break, so until we're back on air, we're showcasing a few programmes from our archive. As usual, the music's been shortened for rights reasons. This week's guest is the actor Lauren Bacall. Roy Plumley cast her away in 1979.
Our castaway this week is a star of Hollywood movies and of the New York and London stage. It's Lauren Bacall. Miss Bacall, how important is music to you?
Oh, well, music is very important.
How did you set about choosing this miserable ration of 8 records?
It is a miserable ration because there are so many more things. I just thought that I would like to hear different sounds. I would like a variety.
Right. Where do we start? What's the first one?
Ella Fitzgerald singing Isn't It a Pity by George and Ira Gershwin.
Why do you choose that one particularly?
Well, I love the whole Gershwin songbook that Ella recorded, and that has always been one of my most favorite Gershwin songs. I love the way she does it.
Here we are at last. It's like a dream. The two of us, a perfect team. Isn't it a pity we never met before?
Ella Fitzgerald, Isn't It a Pity? Now, you're a Brooklyn girl and you became stage struck. Can you track that back to any particular event?
No, I don't consider myself a Brooklyn girl, funnily enough. I lived there for 5 years, but I was brought up in New York, in Manhattan. And I cannot track it back to anything except that it seems to me that as long as I can remember, I guess I wanted to be something that I wasn't.
You went to the movies a lot as a youngster?
I went to the movies a lot, and I first wanted to be a dancer. Ballerina.
What about the theater? Did you go to the theater as well?
Well, I went to the theater once or twice, but the theater was a little beyond me because it was too expensive. Mm. And the first play I ever saw was John Gielgud in Hamlet.
Not a bad introduction.
Oh, and not a bad introduction at all. And that absolutely did me in. I mean, I was so moved by it, even though I was really very, very young. And I remember bumping into people as I was leaving the theater. I was really dazed.
Did you see yourself as a dancer more than an actress?
No. I first wanted to be a ballerina, and then, of course, I realized at a very early age that with the help of a pronouncement of a famous Russian teacher named Michael Mordkin, who had been a dancer, that I really didn't have the feet for it. I was just in constant pain when I was on point. Oh. No Margot Fonteyn, I...
Now, you went to the American Academy of Dramatic Art, but money ran out after only 1 year. When you left, were there any jobs going?
Well, no. I mean, I was hoping they'd give me a scholarship, but they needed young men more than they needed girls, so they gave the scholarships to the males, I'm afraid. No, I just started to look for work, and then I went into modeling I had modeling on 7th Avenue because I had to make some kind of money.
And the usual things of up and down the agent stairs and auditions. You had one good idea, to sell theater papers outside a theatrical restaurant, outside Sardi's.
Yes.
So that your face got sort of familiar.
That shows that I was crazy from the very beginning, doesn't it? That I was just determined that I was going to be noticed as I was going in and out of those producers' offices, pounding pavements, looking for work. And I decided that I was not just going to be one of the actresses that was just, oh, yes, come back tomorrow or come back next week or whatever. And I said, they're going to remember me somehow differently. And I prevailed upon the man that published Actors Q, his Actors magazine, giving tips as to what was being cast. And I sold it outside of Sardi's during my lunch hour. I would come up from the garment center, rush into Walgreens, get the Actors Q, stand in front of Sardi's, and buttonhole anyone that I recognized at all, hoping they would never forget me.
Well, you were a theater usher, what we'd call a program seller here, but in civilized New York, they don't charge for programs. And you were such a very good theater usher that you were given a notice by one of the critics.
Oh, well, yes, George G. Nathan, whom I made quite a production of it. I mean, that was my part, you understand. And I was standing there, and I would always, at the interval, I would say, "No smoking, please." And I would give this delivery, playing all kinds of I don't know what dramas. But he was very sweet. He used to, once a year, he wrote the best and worst of the year. And I was in the best column, fortunately, as the prettiest usher, he thought, at the St. James Theatre.
Man of great taste. What was the first time you walked a stage professionally?
In a play called Johnny 2x4, in which I had what I called an outstanding walk-on. I mean, to anyone else, a walk-on is a walk-on. But to me, if you walked on the stage in three acts, which I did, each of the three acts, to me that was outstanding because I was given extra stuff to do.
Of course.
You see.
And the first line you spoke, what was that in?
The first line I spoke was in a play called Franklin Street, which was directed by George S. Kaufman and produced by Max Gordon, one of the men I buttonholed outside of Sardi's.
Opened in Wilmington, Delaware, and where did it go from there?
And it went to Washington from there and down the drain after that.
Bad luck.
Yes.
So it was back to modeling for a bit.
So then, yes. But then I was fortunate in that I was able to get into photographic modeling, and thereby hangs a tale.
We'll get to that tale in a minute. Let's have record number two. What's that to be?
That is to be Rachmaninoff playing his own piano concerto number two in C minor, conducted by Leopold Stokowski.
And why do you choose this?
Because it's just beautiful.
An excerpt from the Rachmaninoff Second Piano Concerto in C minor with the composer at the piano. Now, you were back to modeling, but this was rather superior modeling. This was photographic modeling.
Yes, well, this was the big money, you see. I mean, for me, $10 an hour. That was not what we say in America, hey. Now, of course, they get $500 an hour. I don't know, but I mean, it was $10 an hour then.
$10. That's a lot of money.
And how? And Harper's Bazaar?
Now, there was a cover picture for Harper's Bazaar that is part of this tale that hangs on photographic modeling.
Thereby, yes.
Yes. Tell me about this cover.
That was a blood donor standing in front of a Red Cross door, yes, with blood donor marked on it.
This was wartime,
yes, wartime. We used to give, everyone was prevailed upon to give a pint of blood or a quart, depending upon how much you could spare.
Yes.
Anyway, that kind of cinched my my position in Hollywood, unbeknownst to me, you understand. I mean, Slim Hawks, who was then married to Howard Hawks, had seen my photograph in other Harper's Bazaars, and then she saw the cover, and she just thought that I was worth looking at.
Yes.
She told Howard, and...
So, off on the train to California, how old were you?
I was 17.
So, there were tests and all that sort of thing.
Oh, yes. There was a lot of waiting, though, I'll tell you, before the tests.
Was there a long process of grooming and teeth straightening and all
oh,
the
no,
rest of the shenanigans?
Oh, no. When I went for my test, for my contract, of course, I was taken to Pierce Westmore at Warner Brothers, and Pierce Westmore sat me down in front of a mirror and looked at me and said, "Well, now, if we tweeze your eyebrows, make a thin line like Dietrich's, then we straighten your teeth, then we do something with your hairline." I thought, I was panic-stricken, rushed to the phone to call Hawks, said, "Oh, they're going to change everything. Please, please come down, help, help." And he came down and he said, "No, Pierce, leave it just as she is. I want the crooked eyebrows, I want the crooked teeth, the crooked hair, the crooked everything." And that's what he got.
The real McCall.
Yeah.
Were you broken in easily by playing bits and pieces at the studio?
No, not at all. No, I was tested for a contract first, and I played a scene from a play called Claudia, which Howard directed. And as a result of that test, he signed me to a personal contract. And then before I was put into To Have and Have Not, which was, mind you, lap dissolve of some months, nigh onto a year, I had to test for that so that Jack Warner, who owned the studio, could give his approval and also buy half of my contract in order for him to allow me to play in the film.
I see. So straight away, a starring part opposite Humphrey Bogart. Were you a fan of his? Was he one of your favorites?
No. No. I mean, I knew he was a good actor, but he was not my type, I didn't think.
Mm. He'd already had, of course, terrific successes, Petrified Forest, Casablanca, whatever. Now, during the shooting, you and Bogart fell in love, and you stayed together in a number of pictures, The Big Sleep from Raymond Chandler. Nice story about The Big Sleep, that in the middle of it, the producer had to ring Raymond Chandler and ask who did the killing, because...
No, who pushed Owen Taylor off the pier? That was funny. Yes, Howard did that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That was fun. Bogey walked in one day and said, Howard, who pushed Owen Taylor off the pier? Oh, now let me see. He said, I don't know. I couldn't figure that out. The Big Sleep was quite a mystery.
Yeah.
But it was terrific.
So you became Mrs. Bogart. How many films did you do together?
Altogether, four.
Yeah, four. Is that all?
That's all. And I haven't been in that many more, actually. Mm. I mean, I have been in more, but maybe about 15.
Your third record, what's that to be?
Sir John Gielgud reading a sonnet from Ages of Man.
Why?
Because I have seen the production of Ages of Man. I saw it several times because I love John Gielgud on the stage and personally, and because it is a record of such variety that on that island, I could go from youth to middle age to old age, and I could let my imagination run wild.
I love to hear her speak, yet well I know that music hath a far more pleasing sound. I grant I never saw a goddess go. My mistress, when she walks, treads on the ground. And yet, by heaven, I think my love as rare as any she belied with false compare.
Sir John Gielgud. Now, you were launched with a terrific publicity barrage with your first picture, The Look. And there you were, looking sexily from under your eyelid. Whose idea was that? I mean, this was the studio's rather desperate thing. How are we going to launch this girl?
No, 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 no. You've got it all wrong. It wasn't the studio at all. It was Howard Hawks.
Mm-hmm.
But it also was because I was a nervous wreck and because I used to shake all the time. Now I only shake some of the time. But in order to keep my head still, I discovered that if I held my chin down, I was able to keep my head a bit steadier. And then I looked up at Bogart, and that became The Look. That combined with Howard Hawks's placement of the camera and angle and all of that, and then he decided that he liked it, and that's the way we did it.
Yes.
But that was Howard. That wasn't the studio.
Did you find the great Jack Warner, who took half your contract and had to give approval of everything, did you find him a very difficult man?
I found him very difficult and not great.
Right, that sums him up. Now, the other Hollywood films you made without Humphrey Bogart.
I loved How to Marry a Millionaire.
Yes.
And I enjoyed Woman's World very much. I liked my role in it. I liked, kind of liked Young Man with a Horn, some of it. I adored Designing Woman. That probably is my favorite film.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved Murder on the Orient Express.
Yes.
I haven't been in that many films, you know. I have not been in that many good ones, certainly, and I haven't been in that many altogether.
You had the extreme misfortune to lose your husband. Did you stay on and live in Hollywood, or did you go back to make films after that?
Oh, no. Well, I went back to make a film after that. I stayed on for, I guess just under 2 years, and then I really couldn't hack it anymore. I mean, I just didn't feel that I belonged there anymore. So I came to England and then went back to New York because I was offered a play, and that gave me a reason to go to New York, and I had my two young children with me, so it takes a while, you know, to try to organize your life again so that you know that you have one.
Of course. We've got to record four. What's that?
That is Moszkowski's Etude in A-flat, played by Vladimir Horowitz.
Moszkowski's Etude in A-flat. Do you play the piano?
No, I studied. My sweet mother did what many mothers do, and that is she gave me lessons, and I learned to play By the Spring by Mendelssohn, and I played it over and over 9,000 times, and that's all I ever could play because
nice
I
piece,
hated practicing.
As you said, you went back to the theater, and at last a starring part on Broadway, but it didn't work all that well, that
The first one, no. But it gave me a taste of the theater, which was my first love.
Mm.
And also, I could sense that I functioned well on the stage, and yes. I really loved it. And it gave me a reason to go back to New York, of course. That changed my life.
That was Goodbye, Charlie.
That was Goodbye, Charlie by George Axelrod, who was a great friend of mine and still is.
And the next play was a much better proposition altogether.
Yes, the next play came a few years after that, was Cactus Flower.
A French play.
A French play, translated by Abe Burrows and directed by Abe Burrows. It had been a great success in France, and it was a booming success in New York, and it was my first hit, and it was wonderful.
How long did you play it?
I played it 2 years nonstop with 1 week's holiday in between. I thought it was my finish.
And then an even more exciting success, your next stage venture.
Yes, Applause.
Applause, based on All About Eve, and you played the Betty Davis part.
Yes, you see. Your life does come back to haunt you, doesn't it?
Betty Davis was the first movie actress you ever met, is that right?
Oh, yes, yes. And she was my great heroine.
Mm.
She was my imagination, my fantasy, that big screen, all those dark victory and all that, so dramatic, so wonderful. And to finally be playing a musical version of the part that she created was very curious. I mean, made me feel very strange.
That was a good long run, too.
That was a very good long run. That took up 5 years of my life, including the American tour, Broadway, and London.
You played in London for what, about a year?
Yeah. I mean, I played that part too long. It made me really gaga. I was crazed by the end of it.
And you stayed on here for a film, one you've already mentioned, Murder on the Orient Express, one that you liked.
Yes.
Now, you've got a new film coming up.
Yes, called Health, to be directed and produced by Robert Altman. And in it will be your Glenda Jackson and Carol Burnett and James Garner. And I play, so Robert Altman tells me, an 83-year-old virgin, which I think is wonderful.
A challenge. Where are you making it?
In Florida, mm-hmm. At an old folks' hotel there in Florida. Oh, I don't know, but I mean, you say yes to Robert Altman, you say terrific, and whatever he says is what you do, because he's... I'm just thrilled to be working with a man that has that much talent.
Yeah. A new vista. Right, record number 5. Where have we got to?
We have got to Brahms' Violin Concerto, played by Isaac Stern, a friend of mine, and conducted by Eugene Ormandy.
Thank you.
An excerpt from the Brahms Violin Concerto in D, Isaac Stern with the Philadelphia Orchestra, conducted by Eugene Ormandy. Now, you've written a book.
Yes, I have indeed.
And you wrote it all yourself, no fooling.
All by myself. And it's called By Myself.
It's obviously a very honest book, a very emotional book. At times, I found an unbearably sad book.
Really? I hope you laughed, though,
some of the time.
Indeed, I mean, I wanted people to laugh.
It's a long book. How long did it take you to write?
It's not as long as I wrote, I can tell you. Aren't you glad that some of it's been cut? It took me over 3 years to write.
Do you plan to write another?
I would love to be able to write another. No, I can't write another autobiography, right? So I have to think of something else. Mm. But, I mean, it's too early. I have to enjoy this one first. I would love to be able to write again because I love writing.
Another record.
Now we have Noel and Gertie. We have them playing a scene from Red Peppers.
Why do you choose that one?
I think it's such fun. I mean, I love the whole record, but I just think that is just terrific fun. And I knew Noel very well. He was a good friend of mine, and I just love to hear him do it.
Right! What's to be done with a drunken sailor, so the saying goes? We're not tied for winning two bridegroom's caught, I don't suppose. We lost our way and we lost our pain to make the thing complete. We've been and gone and lost the blooming fleet. Has anybody seen our ship, the HMS Peculiar? We've been on shore for a month or more. When we see the captain, we shall get what for. Heave ho, my hearties, sing glory, hallelujah.
Red Peppers from Tonight at 8:30, Noel Card and Gertrude Lawrence. Now, desert island problems, are you a practical lady? Could you look after yourself?
Well, I always thought I was practical, but I don't know. I
mean, are you an open-air type? Do you like...
Yes, I love the out-of-doors, but I mean, on a desert island, that's it. You better love the out-of-doors. Where else do you go?
You've done a fair amount of sailing, of course.
Yes, I have, but, I mean, that's not going to help me on a desert island.
Well, if some kind of craft or a raft became available, would you try to escape?
I think if I could not see land anywhere, I don't know if I would. I don't think I would, probably. Mm-mm. I think I'd just rot on this island.
Well, you have another record to rot to. What would you have?
Yes. Oh, well, this one I'm writing to Nat King Cole just because I like Nat King Cole.
Tell me why you keep fooling little coquette, making fun of the ones who love you, breaking hearts you are ruling, little coquette.
Nat King Cole, which leaves you with just one record, one more. What's that to be?
That is Giacomo Puccini's La Bohème, the love duet between Rudolfo and Mimi, sung by Placido Domingo and Montserrat Caballé. And you can hardly do better than that.
Love duet from the end of Act One of Puccini's La Bohème, Placido Domingo and Montserrat Caballé. If you could take only one of the 8 discs you played for us, which would it be?
That's a dirty trick.
I know.
Taking 7 of my records away from me. You are mean. Well, I suppose, as I would have to hear a voice, and I don't think I could listen to the music over and over again as much as I love it, I think I probably would have to choose The Ages of Man.
John Gielgud's The Ages of Man. And one luxury to take to the island with you.
I thought some suntan lotion.
Of course.
I mean, overexposure we know is bad. It'd have to be a very large bottle, though.
Certainly, as many as you like.
Oh, good. Yes. Oh, thank you. You're so generous.
And one book, apart from the Bible and Shakespeare, which are already on the island, and we put the bar up on big encyclopedias.
Oh, we did. I think as of this moment, I would probably choose the stories of John Cheever. Because John Cheever, I don't know if you're familiar with him or
not.
No,
I'm not.
But he is, I think, our greatest American writer. This is a collection of short stories of his that has just been published in America. And it's a wonderful, I mean, great cross-section of 20 years or 30 years of his writing.
The short stories of John Cheever. And thank you, Lauren Bacall, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
And thank you for taking seven of them away from me.
Goodbye, everyone.